Climb on board as we take a journey into outer space. Meet stars Matt Damon, Drew Barrymore, and Bill Pullman. Learn about state-of-the-art computer animation and find out how a movie soundtrack comes together. The quest for the Titan begins now.
This is a movie called Titan AE. AE stands for After Earth. Earth has been blown up, and now Earthlings are kind of the marginal society of the universe.
Humans, wait.
This story is about a boy thrown into a situation beyond his control and being told that the destiny of the world is at his hands.
I happen to be humanity's last great hope.
I weep for the species.
Akima and Cale, they're both human in a world where I think they feel very distinctly different from the many other creatures that are running about.
Without a planet, we're no longer a threat.
She's a female fighter pilot. That's very sexy.
Let's hope she starts.
Korso, who is kind of a space pirate. There is quite a, it's a motley crew, pre... and Gune.
Applied in the same force.
And Stith.
Three! Things aren't bad enough! Tools all over the floor!
In a way, it reminds me of a pirate ship.
The dredge is the evil villain in this case. And it's a single entity that can become many entities. The dredge are pure energy and there's no way to beat them.
The dredge want you, only dead.
How do you know they want me dead?
We have about 26 animators. There's a total of about 312 artists and technicians on the movie. Every scene is a difficult scene to do. There is so much eye candy and so much going on that it makes it difficult to get the scenes through the system. Design-wise, I think it's a constant struggle between reality and art. We take the ideas that were in the Hubble photographs of different distant nebulas that look like brilliant cloud formations with colors that we'd never thought of being in outer space. How do we take those now and make them like something you think you've seen before, but pushed beyond?
You get into some of the fabulous things you've seen from the Hubble, so that you get into nebulas and what it looks like in space and all the rules of space. So then you begin to make some drawings here and there, saying, what do the characters look like? What's Cale like? You know, if he's a tough guy with a chip on his shoulder, is he well built? Is he sort of a skinny guy? Well, those images are dictated by the voice. So if you listen to Matt Damon's voice,
right, sir,
then there's a certain way in my head that he will look.
If I don't like the way things are going, I'll show you how much like my father I really am.
Matt Damon and Drew Barrymore and I were in this session in New York. And there's a lot about this process that reminds me more of improv, because all the details of the story and the different aspects of the journey were all so kind of roughed out, and then they're constantly evolving, that you have to be just accessible when you come in to do sessions.
You look so silly doing it. You can't feel too embarrassed at how it looks, because it's got to sound right, you know?
Next time, plot us a course that takes us around the shiny, pretty things.
She has the sexiest, softest, sweetest voice. And we said, wait a minute, this is a soldier we're making here. So I said, Drew, don't do sexy sweet. Be tough.
So when he said that he wanted her to be tough, I was really happy that the direction I'd been going in or thinking about going in, that he was advocating.
Gune?
John Leguizamo is playing the part of Gune. Gune is a navigator.
But he's kind of like a goofy, little mad scientist alien character.
Multiplied by the coefficient of the friction.
Yeah, well, they give you the script, you get the character. So I said, you know, let me try this thing. I've been wanting to do this sort of Peter Lorre futuristic. These boys, they talk this way. And that's where we ended up with that character.
But I plot new route through Safer Quadrant.
He's got some very funny textures, some very funny readings in the way that they time out. In other words, it's almost like music where you go da 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 da. You know, and it's the same way animators think, the same way musicians think, and obviously the same way John thinks.
And I'd have to like take a huge like week break of talking because the voice really strained my vocal cords.
Tap into the central computer and reconfigure the departure protocols. Yes.
Janeane Garofalo is the ammunitions expert.
You come in and you do your verbal work, and then they may animate around that.
Well, I'll kill him. Preed, I'll kill you. Okay, I will kill you. Oh!
Nathan Lane is Preed, is an alien, is cocky. He's at the same time intellectual, a little snobby.
He works on the ship, the Valkyrie, and is sort of the right-hand man, or lizard, if you will, to Korso.
There, Captain.
He's sort of a strange-looking alien who speaks very elegantly.
Fight the good fight, precious.
When we return to the quest for the Titan, a visit to Fox Animation, where you'll meet the animators, see how they created the props, and take a walk in space.
Listening to the recordings, it's almost like shutting your eyes to listen to the acting, and then you almost have to put your life experience into it. I can listen to a bit of dialogue, and I'll know that you have to put a real subtle head shake in there. You got to do some real subtle things with the eyes, like if they're talking through their teeth or something. Then you actually have to capture the essence of that performance.
We need a pickup here.
A little late for that.
So Don will then storyboard after that. What we do is then build an animatic. That means that he takes the storyboard and then we put dialogue track to it, and you can actually get the moving comic at that stage.
They're locking down the doors!
Not going forward, going up!
No matter how good your animators are, when you start dealing with human characters, we all know how we move. So we shoot an awful lot of live-action reference for the human characters in our films.
We set the thing up, we bring the actors in, the director explains to them where they are, what they're going to be doing, and then we get a performance.
Well, this would be good if we had any baking to do.
I built the space scooter. The actor who played Cale had to sit on something that was movable. Before I cut it in half, it was a jet ski. And if you've ever tried to cut a jet ski in half, you'd really appreciate that. Some of the guns were created just as props. I cut various things up. A lot of sprinklers, for example, became ray guns. I look at things that look like spaceship parts to me. You know, and the guy comes over and says, can I help you? And you say, well, not really.
After the animator's done the key drawings, it goes to our assistants, and they'll finish off any keys that are kind of half done. Then we'll go to an in-between department, which will do all the in-between motion. So if you have a key here of a guy holding a glass and his other key is here, you'll have all these drawings in between.
Regular live action camera speed is 24 frames a second. More often than not, we have to do 24 drawings a second. People will ask me, like, how long would it take to, you know, get your arm to move up? And I'd say, well, it depends on, you know, sometimes it can take 60 drawings, sometimes it can take one drawing. It just depends on how fast you want it to move.
When animation has finished and rough in between has finished, it comes into our department. What we do is we get the scene and put the final graph outline on. But before that, we also make sure that like design is following through. And to help us in that, we get model sheets of every character. And what we basically do is we try and make all the characters look the same throughout the film.
Production design is really just encompassing the entire design of the picture from a drawing standpoint, not from a color standpoint. We design everything from the sets, the ships, the environments. We got involved in the alien characters.
If the director, Don, wants to move the camera, that instantly calls for a 3D environment. It would be very tough to paint 2D backgrounds that move. Another case would be a lot of the animation of props, be them handheld props or in scale of the ships.
This is one of the props used for live action reference for the animation. For the 3D scenes,
all that references scanned in to help me in animating him. I could then again use the prop and hold it and see how he's supposed to move with it.
It was our assignment to create a man in a spacesuit. We taped them up rather efficiently so that we could get some marking points for which to reg our 3D prop to. So the next thing we had to do, we worked on building the spacesuited man in the computer. So we got the suit man built, put the two together, and we came up with a result looking like that. Using the same spaceman, the next test was to see if he can walk. Taking the same character walking, we turned one half a walk into a full walk cycle. There's a great advantage to doing it 3D. And came up with this. We said, wait a minute, what if we didn't mean to shoot him from that angle? What if the intention was we need spacemen walking all over this space station? Move your camera, you got the same prop, it's already built.
Once they do that, they've got it to a place where we could scan that into a computer and then assign colors to all of those shapes that are on the character. And then the real job is what color?
You know, we're using certain color principles. For example, a lot of Earth-type situations are very much in warm, green, you know, very earthy palettes. Electronic colors, we restricted to the dredge. Titan. In relation to look and style, there's very much aggressive style of lighting, very high contrast.
That's a negative, Captain. I think we've fallen in with a very bad crowd.
If a character is sitting on a chair, we would have to address every issue. What type of lighting is on the character? Do we want the environment to oppress the character? And we'd use that with lighting.
That ship has the power.
At the same time that's happening, we have created the sets in a whole nother department. So what's behind those characters have been drawn. What we do is we paint those. That's still a very hand process. Those then are scanned into the computer. And there in the computer, we may light those differently. We'll change the colors. We'll make it look more realistic. And then we'll bring that background and the character that we've colored together.
98% of the movie is special effects. It's very important that the work that goes into the 3D animation of effects is mixed with the 2D drawn effects so that the audience always believes that it's all part of the same picture.
There's something extremely realistic about this film and the way it looks and feels.
When we return to the quest for the Titan, a look at the ice crystals, the sound effects, and the destruction of Earth.
Everyone has seen 3D explosions in most live-action movies. Here, it has to be designed to fit in the movie, but also designed to look beautiful. If it's a beautiful explosion that makes you wow, I think you've done your job there.
I'm working on the construction or the destruction of the Earth, and what I've got is a wireframe model of the Earth here that was taken from a scanned image of fault lines drawn on the continents, then wrapped around the sphere. Then take these 2D images and cut out the object and explode it on out as a piece of the world just flying apart. Each of these pieces represent one of the cut items from the sphere, so they all have mass and they fly out in 3D space. It's one of many things that that I get to destroy here at Fox Animation. It's kind of fun.
I don't think as a production designer this movie could have come to life the way that it has had it not been for the team that worked on Star Wars. The sequences that they did are high action, huge ice crystal sequences.
We previously worked on Star Wars Episode I. This is the sequence at the end of the film where our good guy spaceship is trying to finally discover the Titan. And there were some great storyboards of it. And then there was some stuff that I wanted to try some different ideas with.
When we build the sequence, we've got
final shots like this mixed with animatics like this. Because we only want to work on a shot in the final form if we know that we need it.
The environment was given to us, which was this ice crystal environment, and we loved that because it allowed us to play this cat and mouse reflection game rather than just a chase. One day we got a brainstorm that we should have these crystals that they're constantly moving around and being kind of dangerous. Two of them collide with each other, and that forms a cavern around the ship. So that allows us to have a motivated way that the Phoenix gets in there, and then we can play over all of our games with all the 1,000 images. We had this crystal cavern that was around them, constantly closing in during the course of the scene, just to heighten the danger a little bit. And what you get at the end of the whole thing is a blueprint for the entire sequence.
Because you get to play with spaceships. It's the closest thing to being an astronaut I can do.
Animated films have a more difficult challenge in some respects because you have no guide, and so it demands a certain amount of creativity in the initial phase as to, you know, what are we going to do with this? And a big part of that is sending folks out to record out in the field. We went to one of the Blue Angels air shows. One of the stunts that they did was to blow up a bunch of old gasoline. These guys, as nuts as they are, got really close to this and came up with a very concussive blast. The ice crystal scene, I was looking to do two different things. One, I was looking to sonically let the audience feel the size of these immense crystallized ice forms as they move by us and ultimately crash into each other and start breaking apart. At the same time, I felt that these ice crystals had a character, that they really were unto themselves a character within the film. And so I wanted to give them a voice. I started playing with rock breaks and the sound of ice breaking on a frozen sheet of ice, and I would break it with my foot. At one point when I was skiing, I woke up one morning and found it was very, very dry, and the snow had the most strange, squeaky quality to it. So I went out with my recorder in the morning, and I started doing things with my pole, where I stabbed my pole into this dried snow and then slowly let it. This sound here was the sound of my feet on this ice sheet slowly breaking. And it gives you this very crunchy quality that.
When we return to the quest for the Titan, a look at the making of a movie soundtrack, including Over My Head from the rock group Lit.
Songs for this piece. Electricity wrote a song called Cosmic Castaway, which really sets up our character of Cale. The band Texas talked about the picture, and I ended up writing a song with them. When Cale understands what it really is like to be human, it's a very sweet moment in the picture. Lit ended up writing for a scene. Our hero, Cale, decides he can repair the ship. Lit came up with this wonderful song called Over My Head.
My name is Jeremy Popoff. I'm the guitar player for the rock group Lit. There was this animated movie that was coming out in the summer, and they were interested in having us write a song for it.
You kind of get the inspiration from the movie and pretty much write the song like you would any other Lit song.
I think it's animation that older people can get into. I'd be into it.
This kid gets put in this position that he didn't ask to be put in. A lot of weight is on his shoulders, and the song is called Over My Head.
I'm looking forward to going into the theater and hearing the song, you know, and the surround sound, and I think that's going to be like the payoff.
It is an evolving, collaborative journey.
There's a lot of action in it, and it doesn't let you rest.
Boys will be, like, into the action, and, you know, girls will feel empowered.
There's just something really, for the lack of a better word, trippy about it.
I think they're going to sit back and be taken on a journey that is visually so different.
It's not your song and dance animated movie.
It's a dirtier film. It's down to earth. It's grungy.
It just takes you back like that. That's what I'm hoping.